Who doesn't want to learn to be softer with themselves instead of so harsh, especially with our inner child? That's what we're going to be talking about today, part one of a two-part series based on this book, Try Softer by Aundi Kolber. I am so glad that you're joining me today for Heart in a Drawer, the podcast for adult children of divorce. I am Sarah Geringer, your host, and I've been doing this podcast for about a year. If you're new here, welcome. If you've been with me for a while, I'm so glad that you've joined me again today. So before we get started on this part one of this book discussion, I want to remind you of two important things. One is this podcast is never meant to be a substitute for mental or health care, but it's meant to be a supplement to Christian counseling, which I received myself to get the healing and find the hope that I needed. And I leave a link in the show notes for you to check out how you can have a free consultation call like I had myself years ago. Secondly, I want to remind you that I have started a Patreon community, and if you donate, you'll get exclusive resources each time that I publish an episode and each month if you join at certain tiers. So be sure to check that out. Now we're going to start part one of this discussion on Try Softer. So when I got this book a few weeks ago, I knew that it was resonating with me because I use these little paper markers in my book, and I had five of them in the first chapter. So there's so much I could discuss from this book, but basically I've pulled two main concepts, and we're going to talk about the first one today, which is reparenting. So maybe you're like me and you have a harsh inner critic. I am an Enneagram 1 Wing 9. Enneagram 1s have the harshest inner critic of all. If you have a 1 Wing, you might have a harsh critic inside. And I even think if that's not necessarily your placement on the Enneagram, growing up as a child of divorce, you may have had very critical parents. And they might have been critical to one another. They might have been critical toward you or your siblings. Might have been a step-parent, a step-grandparent. There's just a lot of families that I know who have been affected by divorce where criticism really plays a big part in the dysfunction. And that was certainly true in my case. And I think that's why I started marking pages right away in this book, because I could really identify with what she talked about. I'm going to read a quote from page 2. She says, "I was in a constant state of overwhelm as an adult. Having grown up in an intensely dysfunctional and chaotic family, I never fully learned how to hold the pain of others without internalizing it." So I wonder if that is a struggle for you. I have had to learn to detach with love, and I learned this through my therapy sessions with my counselor, that when you detach with love, not detach with coldness, but you detach with love, you are giving that person space to grow and heal on their own. If you're overcompensating, if you're constantly taking on more than really what is your emotional load or your relational load, you're not giving those people room to grow, and you're inhibiting your own growth. And I had to learn that. I had to become aware of it by my counselor's wisdom, and then I had to start practicing letting go gently instead of letting go with indifference or coldness on my part. So I understood what she meant when she mentioned that. And then a couple pages later, she talks about this. She said, "The danger from my past was gone, but the patterns remained, and they were keeping me from being able to be truly present and pay attention to what matters most." So I wonder if there are patterns from your past that are affecting you right now that you really haven't necessarily identified yet, but you feel like you're never really getting where you want to be. You're always rushed, and when it's quiet, you feel anxious inside. And so this book has so many good tips on helping you be more mindful and do this in a God-pleasing way. And one of those tips that we're going to look at in depth today is called reparenting. So in, I believe it's my most popular podcast episode to date called "What's Your Attachment Style?" And I will leave that in the comments of in the show notes. Well, I talk about different attachment styles that people have, and she really goes into depth in this discussion about those attachment styles. So you can go back and listen to that episode. I think it's really informative, and that's why people enjoyed it, because I talk about the attachment styles that not only you have, but that you can notice in your spouse or your children, and then you can start to handle things in a more proactive and healthy way. So what she says is, if we grew up with an insecure attachment style, are we doomed? Can that be healed? Can we too experience God and others as safe? Thankfully, the answer is yes. Our internal working models can, in fact, be changed or repaired. When this happens, it's referred to as earned secure attachment, which appears to happen in two steps. First, we internalize a secure and autonomous attachment after developing a meaningful emotional relationship with a close friend, significant other, or therapist. Because of this nurturing connection, we are able to create a healthier inner voice, one that sounds like the parent we needed, kind, gentle, compassionate. So let me pause here and just say, I don't know who that is for you. She said a close friend, significant other, or therapist. So it doesn't have to be a husband or wife, although that can often be the case. I think this is where the whole body of Christ comes into play. I've said here and there on other episodes that we need to seek out a mother figure, a father figure in the church to help us see a healthier model attached to someone who doesn't have all the baggage that we have from our own experiences with our parents, and then learn that health and hope and growth is possible through a new relationship with them. And I think one of the best ways to do that is through mentoring. I've done a podcast episode on that, and I'll link that in the show notes as well. And also, though, she's right in terms of, for my experience, my therapist. So I think that I gravitated toward a male therapist because subconsciously I knew that my father wound was probably the deepest one that needed healing, and I needed to see someone who was healthy and whole to guide me through that healing process. And I really do believe that God led me to choose to spend 5 years with that therapist. And occasionally I go back just for tune-ups, is what I call them. And he is really like, honestly, like a spiritual father to me. And I'm so, so grateful that God used him in his way, in completely professional relationship, but yet I was getting that void filled in me through him. And that is such a blessing. And I can also think of other older men in my church, my grandpa, I think, would have been that kind of person to help kind of heal that wound. And so I'm telling you that because I want you to know it's definitely possible and it's within your reach if you'll put yourself out there and let people meet that need for you. And of course, that takes time. So you have to be willing to invest that time to build that relationship with someone. And then she says, using the prefrontal cortex, we've talked about this brain development before. That's the part of your brain that develops the latest. And so it's the most advanced, reason and sorting out feelings, that kind of thing. So she says, using that area of our brains, we can begin to observe where we feel wounded in areas of attachment and reparent them when we feel rejected, isolated, overly self-reliant, or scared. The second step occurs when we are able to coherently tell our story and understand from our own perspective why events happened. So one of my friends said when she went through therapy, it was kind of like getting things out from her heart and putting them out here, out in front of her, so she could examine them and see them. They weren't causing turmoil inside anymore, necessarily. The therapy helped her take it out here, so then she could look at them from a more objective perspective with her counselor's help. And I love that just simple picture of what Aundi Kolber is saying here. And I feel like this little sidebar, I'll show you YouTubers right here, was worth the entire price of this book for me. So she says, ways to talk to your inner child in a reparenting style. Just 5 bullet points. I'm going to go through these slowly. This is what you can say to your inner child when you're feeling riled up inside by trauma or triggers or stress or anything like that. You can say, I'm listening. That's one of them. I'm listening. Number 2, I'll set whatever boundaries are needed to help you feel safe. That is very powerful. I'm going to be doing a 3-part series on boundaries in a few weeks. So that's a really good one. Number 3, you're not alone anymore. Now, we've spent a lot of time talking about loneliness, and a way to overcome that is to speak that truth to your inner child, because God is always with you. Number 4, I believe you. How many of us had our ideas, our words, our opinions negated when we were kids if we were in a critical atmosphere? So telling our inner child in a reparenting style, I believe you, is validating, it's affirming, it's empowering. Just 3 little words you can say. And then finally, the 5th one is, it's over now. Let's figure out a new way to be. I love that one because I can get stuck in the past. And I love the fact that that's saying, that's in the past, but I have the power through God, through connecting with others, to figure out a new way to be now. So I just really loved those 5 little bullet points that she used. And in the worksheet that I'm going to put in Patreon, I'm going to list out Bible verses that we can claim as affirmations attached to each one of these truths that she laid out here, among other things that I'll put in that worksheet for your benefit. So we have really just scratched the surface, but I wanted to take that reparenting angle from this book today, because I think many of us in our healing process as adult children of divorce really need to heal that inner child inside us and talk to it differently so that we can move forward with greater hope. So let me say a prayer for us to close us out today. And then I have one more ask of you at the end. Father God, I just thank and praise you, Lord, that you are our perfect parent. You are our Abba Father. You are our daddy, our papa. And you never mistreat us. You never abandon us. You never leave us alone. You're always with us. And what a blessing and a gift it is to know that when we choose to follow you, Lord. And you can see that little boy or little girl inside all of us who are listening today. And you know the kind of healing that that little child inside needs. And I thank you that Jesus welcomed the little children to him and said, the kingdom of heaven belongs to such as these. You want to reparent that little child inside. I trust that, Lord. I believe that, Lord. And I welcome that healing in me, and I pray it upon each person listening today. And may they have the resources, the courage, the strength, and the encouragement to reach out, get the help that they need, and start healing from the inside out. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Be sure to join me next time for part two, another wonderful angle from this book. And my final ask is, if you're enjoying this podcast, would you please tell one or two people about it? Because I know that you know another adult child of divorce who could benefit from this show. And the best way to spread the news still in this age of information we live in is word of mouth. So please get in touch with them and share it. And I appreciate everything you're doing to help me grow this podcast. Until next time, I'm praying God's blessings and peace on you. Bye-bye.